have it under the arm, that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Blessed be your name. At the ministry of your word, we pray that you bless us and revive us and restore us. Do that which only you can do. Blessed is your name. In Jesus' name, we pray and give thanks. Amen. God bless you. Let's take our seats. God bless you. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 19. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 19. The date of our message is discipleship. That's what we've been talking about this week. We had a message on discipleship on Tuesday, Wednesday evening, and today, Matthew chapter 4, verse 19. Matthew 4, verse 19. A familiar verse. It says, then he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Then he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. There is an invitation by Jesus to all the believers, to all the Christians. And this invitation is in two phases. Before we reach our destiny, before God does that which only He can do, He can't do so. He does it at the onset, and He's the one who finishes the work. He's the one who begins, and He's the one who finishes. So He has already done it at Calvary. But then, before He finishes the work He has started doing, there are two things you must do. Number one, you must accept the invitation. And that invitation is in two phases. One, come. And two, follow me. So you must say okay to both. You must come. And when you have come, you must follow Him. Now that coming to Jesus, the initial coming to Jesus, is called salvation. The following is called consecration, is called sanctification. And that is where discipleship comes in. Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. That following of Jesus is the practical discipline. Discipleship is a practical discipline of following the Master. And as we follow Him, there is God's eternal plan, which is for every Christian, that ultimately we shall be transformed and be conformed into Christ-likeness. That's the ultimate goal of discipleship. That we will be transformed and conformed to Christ-likeness. The Bible says in Romans chapter 8 and verse 29. Romans 8, 29. For whom He foreknew, He predestinated that they may be conformed into the image of His Son. So God called us that ultimately we attained total godliness. But that will happen in totality when Jesus returns. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 to 3, 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 to 3, the Bible says, behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed to us. Now the world does not know us because it did not know Him. Beloved, we are children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be. But we know that we shall be like Him. When He is revealed, we shall be like Him, for we shall see Him even as He is. And verse 3 says, everyone who has this hope in Him purifies himself even as He is pure. So John is saying, a time is coming that we shall be chained and we shall be like him. But before then, we have that hope, absolute expectation of coming good, of that transformation that one day we shall be made like Christ, we shall be transformed to be like Jesus. But John says, even before then, now we continue to purify ourselves. We continue to consecrate ourselves. We continue to sanctify ourselves. So there is a place of purifying ourselves. It is true that one day we shall ultimately be like Christ. But even now, we don't merely just sit back, but we continue to grow. We are not yet there. We continue to pursue holiness, to pursue that purification. There is a command given to every believer in Hebrews 12 verse 14. Hebrews 12 verse 14, there is a command, pursue peace and holiness, without which no man shall see God. So there's a coming a time when you shall see Jesus and you shall be transformed to be like him. But even now, we are told we pursue peace and holiness, without which no man shall see God. So how do we pursue that holiness? How do we pursue that purity? We pursue it by exercising godliness, exercising spiritual discipline. That is what becoming a disciple is. You exercise spiritual disciplines. Paul writing to Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. He says, reject profane and old wives' fables, and rather discipline yourself for godliness. Exercise yourself for godliness. For bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness profits in all things, having a promise of the life that now is and that which is to come. That is discipleship. Apply godliness. Apply, follow, exercise the spiritual disciplines. The only road towards Christ-likeness, towards Christian maturity and godliness, passes through the practice of spiritual disciplines. And the moment you exercise yourself in the spiritual disciplines, that following of Jesus, in the character, in the words, in the example, the model that Jesus has given us, the moment we exercise, it's no longer a burden. It becomes a blessing to us. It's no longer a tragedy. It becomes a delight doing the things of godliness and practicing those things. What are those things? Every disciple like Jesus, we must see that we follow the way of Bible intake, reading the Bible, studying the Word, meditating on it, memorizing the scriptures, listening, you know, availing yourself to Bible intake, whether it's by hearing or reading or meditating. It's a life of prayer without ceasing. It's a life of learning, it's a life of fasting, it's a life of stewardship, it's a life of giving, it's a life of evangelism, witnessing Christ, it's a life of gathering with the brethren. That's what spiritual disciplines are. And the more we exercise ourselves in those spiritual disciplines, the more we are becoming like Christ, the more we are growing towards maturity, and the more godliness is increasing in life. So godly people are disciplined people. There is no man or woman who attains spiritual maturity without discipline, without exercising him or herself in the mature us, to transform us, so that eventually we confirm, we become more like Christ. Number one is people. God uses people to fly away those rough, ungodly edges in our lives, to prune us, to sharpen us. God uses people. Those people can be, they can be your children, they can be parents, they can be a spouse, they can be a colleague, they can be a neighbor, they can be a friend, they can be an enemy, they can be a master. God uses people. Proverbs 27:17 says, as iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of another man. So God can use people to sharpen us. Not just people, but number two, another method, another agent, change agent, another catalyst used is circumstances. Circumstances. God can use circumstances to grow us spiritually in godliness, in Christ-likeness. He can use financial pressures. He can use economic challenges. He can use, you know, conditions, physical conditions, to sharpen us. Romans 8:28, it says, and we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are called according to his purpose. So whatever you're going through, whether good or bad, as a child of God, as one who loves God and is called according to his purpose, I submit to you, all things are working together for God. God is using even those temptations and trials, whether they came from God or the devil. Joseph said to his brothers, you meant it for evil, but God turned it for good. So anything that is orchestrated or initiated by the enemy in your life, those circumstances that have been brought up by the devil, God is able, they are meant for evil, but God is able to turn them and make them for good. And that which was started by God, Paul says, this is our confidence, that we know whatever he started, he's faithful to complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. So whatever was started by the devil, God will turn it for good. And that which is started by God in your life, he's faithful to complete it. Another place Paul says, I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he's able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. And you know, we have committed our families to God, we've committed our ministries, committed our businesses, we've committed our lives, our past, our present, our future. We've committed unto God. And so we know that all things are working together for God. For us who love God and are called according to his purpose, it is a win-win situation. Whatever circumstances we are in, we know how it will end. We know how it will end. We know God is taking us from glory to glory, not from glory to shame. Amen? Things are becoming better and more glorious and more beautiful. So God can use people to transform us, to become more godly. God can use circumstances. And number three, God can use spiritual disciplines. He can use spiritual disciplines. Like I mentioned earlier, he can use the Bible. Your study of the Bible, can use church training in the prayer, can use prayer, can use fasting. He can use paying your tithes, giving, God's stewardship. He can use your witnessing, your evangelism, all this silence and solitude, journaling, learning, all these are spiritual disciplines. And the way God can use people to sharpen you, the way he can use circumstances to work on you to be more godly, he can also use these spiritual disciplines to push you towards spiritual maturity. Now, this number three is the only method that works inside out. The other methods work outside in. People, circumstances, they work from external towards your inside. But spiritual disciplines, they work from inside and change you to the outside. Again, these spiritual discipline is the only method, the only change agent that you have a choice towards involvement. You see, you may have very little choice when it comes to people and when it comes to circumstances. Some people, some circumstances, you can never wish them away. You can't even pray them away. They are with you day in, day out. I mean, you're in that job, you're in that situation, and there's very little you can do about it. But when it comes to spiritual disciplines, it's you who chooses whether you're going to fast or not. It's you who chooses whether you're going to go to church or not. It's you who chooses whether in the morning you read a chapter or two or not. It's you who chooses whether you're going to give or not. Extend the love of God to people or not. So we have a choice in it. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We're talking about discipleship and how we grow to become more and more like Christ. How we grow in spiritual maturity. Now, on one hand, this holiness we are talking about is a gift from God. On one hand, it's something that is done by God at the initial stage. Jesus said in Luke 12:32, Jesus said, "Fear not, little flock. Fear not. Fear not, little flock. For it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." It delights the Father to give us godliness. Fear not. Again, he said in Ephesians 2:8-9, "By grace are you saved through faith in Jesus Christ, not of works, lest any man should boast." It is the gift from God. And not of it's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So there is a kingdom that is given to us, and there is a salvation we receive by grace, not of any works, no involvement, not of works, lest any man should boast. There is also a rest you receive that is given to you freely. Matthew 11:28, "Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I shall give you rest." Now that is one aspect of our salvation. A kingdom, it's the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. A salvation that is given to us purely by grace as a gift. You don't do anything for to receive a gift. A gift is just given to you. Not of works, lest any man should boast. A rest, "Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I shall give you." But then, after you have answered to that invitation, and it has been given to you, there is now the working out. There is now the following. There is now the application of discipline for you to be able to enjoy, to maximize the kingdom that was given. For you to maximize, you must discipline. The salvation that was given to you freely, for you to maximize, you must do something. The rest, for you to enjoy it, you must do something. How do I know that? Because Matthew chapter 11 verse 12 says, "From the days of John the Baptist, the kingdom of God suffers violence, and the violent take it by force." There is a kingdom that is given, and there is a kingdom that is taken. You must take it by force. There is a salvation that is given as a gift freely, but there is a salvation that is taken now. Philippians 2:12 and 13 says, "Now, brethren, as you have obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you more to will and to do of his good pleasure." Now there is a salvation that is given. "By grace are you saved through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast." It's given. It's a gift. But now Philippians tells us that salvation which was given to you, work it out by fear and trembling. There is a rest that is given. Come unto me, O you that labor and are heavy laden, and I shall give you rest. Given. But after it's given, Matthew 11:28 says, come unto me, O you that labor and are heavy laden, I shall give you rest. Now verse 29 says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest to your souls. You shall find rest to your souls. When you come to Jesus, you receive rest in your spirit. Come unto me, you that labor, and are heavy laden, and I shall give you rest. You receive rest in your spirit, in your heart. But when you discipline yourself in following Jesus as a disciple in the spiritual disciplines, now you begin to enjoy the same rest in your mind, in your soul, in your emotions. Amen. I quoted earlier 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 1 Timothy chapter 4 and 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 7. Let's look at that again. healed the man. Now the next chapter, which is in the next chapter, Luke 19, kind of like immediately after healing Bartimaeus, there's this man called Zacchaeus in Luke 19, now verse 1 to 10. A man of short stature, a tax collector. He hears of Jesus, but there is a challenge because he's short and there's a crowd. But what did he do? Again, he's a rich man. Putting embarrassment aside, he climbs the tree to see Jesus. And you know how Jesus would end up inviting himself in his house, and this man would be saved, give half of his riches to the poor, and to those who he had robbed, he would return four times, whatever he had taken. Let me say this. Discipleship is putting yourself in the path of Jesus Christ and God's grace. Discipleship, when you begin to apply the disciplines of Jesus and you begin to exercise godliness, what you are doing like Bartimaeus and like Zacchaeus, you are presenting yourself in the paths of Jesus Christ and His grace for transformation, for a miracle, and for a blessing. And this is what happened, 2 Corinthians 3:17 and 18. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 17 and 18. The Bible says, the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And we all, with unveiled faces, looking, beholding as in a mirror the glory of God, we are being changed into the same image from glory to glory by the Spirit of the Lord. Every time you are presenting yourself in a spiritual discipline. Maybe you are meditating on the Word of God. Maybe you are attending church. Maybe you are praying, or you're giving yourself in fasting. You are looking at the glory of God. You are encountering God, and in the process, we are changed from glory to glory. Praise the Lord. As I finish, the gold of godliness, is not found on the surface of Christianity. It has to be dug from the depths with the tools of spiritual disciplines. Let me repeat that again. The gold of godliness. The gold of godliness is not found on the surface of Christianity. You must dig it. And as you dig for this gold of godliness, you use the tools of spiritual disciplines. Amen. And if you persevere, if you continue in the practices and in the principles of Jesus Christ, eventually you find that they are more valuable than the troubles you may be going through. They are treasures in prayer. They are treasures in fellowship. They are treasures in the Word of God. They are treasures in stewardship. They are treasures when you come to evangelism. And those treasures are more valuable than the troubles we may be going through. Amen? Praise the Lord. So I want to encourage us that let us apply and practice discipleship, following Jesus. Those disciplines, they are the price for our freedom. Those disciplines. The freedom is the reward we receive from the disciplines of discipleship and following Jesus. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, and we worship you. We bless and honor your name. Thank you, Lord, for discipleship. Thank you, Jesus, for calling us by your grace. Thank you for saving our lives. And now, Lord, we pray in Jesus' name that we shall not be those who throw back to perdition, but even as you have called us, we shall continue. of accountability and confession, the disciplines of studying and learning your ways and all of you. And I pray, Jehovah God, may there be more and more godliness in our life. Transform.